Oops.
Hey, hello, welcome everyone. So today we're very happy to have Marius Deleu from Trinity College Dublin, and he will tell us about the Young-Baxter equation and how to solve it. Please, Marius.
Okay, thanks, and thanks for the opportunity to present this work here. Can everyone hear me fine? Okay, good. So I'll present work today that I've been doing with my group at Trinity College, which consists of Chiara Paletta, Anton Pribitok, Anna Retor, and Paul Ryan, most of who are also in the audience. And the main idea is to find a new method to find solution of the Young-Baxter equation. So the plan for today is the following. I'll discuss the method that we'll use to find and classify solutions of the Young-Baxter equation. And then I'll discuss several applications of our method. So we'll first go to the case where the Hilbert space is two-dimensional. So the solution for the Young-Baxter equations will be 4×4. And I'll discuss some applications to anti de Sitter spaces or integrable models from holography. And then I will go to discuss some more complicated examples in four dimensions and discuss some applications, for example, to the Hubbard model. And I'll discuss with some outlook and open questions. So integrable models are models with a high amount of symmetry. And this makes them very interesting because usually that makes them exactly solvable. And famous examples that you all know from your education are Kepler's problem, the Heisenberg spin chain, the Hubbard model, and also in ADCFT, integrable models have been appearing more and more. And the defining property of an integrable model is basically that there should be a tower of conserved charges, one of which is the Hamiltonian. And like I said, there are many applications in condensed matter and in QFT and string theory. So especially since this is an integrability journal club, I don't need to sell the importance of integrable structures too much, I think. Most of you will know why they are interesting. But the part of integrability that I will focus on today is the Young-Baxter equation. So integrable models are usually characterized by an R matrix, which is an operator R that in integrable field theories is just a scattering matrix, or for example, in integrable spin chains is the crucial operator that allows you to do the quantum inverse scattering method. And in order for this R matrix to be to correspond to an integrable model, it's a solution for the Young-Baxter equation. And for example, when R is a scattering matrix, this corresponds to a consistent way of providing factorized scattering. So it means that if you have three particles to three particle scattering, it doesn't really matter in which order you do it. So you can first scatter particles 1 and 2, then 1 and 3, then 2 and 3, and that should give you the same result as 2 and 3, 1 and 3, and 1 and 2. So this is a consistency requirement for factorized scattering. So written out in generality, you get the equation that's here at the bottom. So it's a cubic equation. So you get R12, R13, R23 is equal to R23, R13, R12. Okay. So, and like I said, the Young-Baxter equation appears in many contexts. It usually indicates the presence of integrable structures, but it also closely related to knot theory and braid groups. It appears in vertex models, like I said, in 1+1-dimensional field theories, where it corresponds to the scattering matrix, but also the definition, for example, of quantum groups. And most recently, people also have been starting to use it in quantum computations and string gauge theory. So it's an important question of how to find solutions of the Young-Baxter equation, and in general, how to classify the solutions. Can you find the catalog of solutions, for example? And that's sort of the main question of that what I want to address today. So I further want to highlight a special case where R, in principle, can depend on the two rapidities of the two particles separately. But there's a special case where it depends on the difference, which corresponds to relativistic theories, so theories that are Lorentz invariant, where you expect everything to depend on the difference of rapidities. And this is a special case, as you will also see in our method. Our method simplifies a little bit in this case, but I'll comment on that later. So traditionally, there are sort of two main approaches to solving a Maxwell equation. I'm a bit general here, but first there is the so-called algebraic approach, where you exploit the high amount of symmetry that's present in integrable models. So you assume that the R matrix exhibits some restrictive symmetry, for example, Youngian symmetry, which is present in lots of integrable models, like, for example, the Heisenberg spin chain. Or you can use, for example, the Temple-Leib algebra and try to apply a vectorization procedure on that to also obtain solutions of the Maxwell equation. So the upside of this approach is that it's relatively easy in the sense that the equations you need to solve are usually linear. So we have an R matrix and you have a compatibility condition of the R matrix with some symmetry, which usually results in a set of linear equations on the components of the R matrix, which are usually very simple to solve. The downside, of course, to this model is that you will only find R matrices that have or manifestly have this symmetry. If you, for example, want an R matrix that is Youngian invariant, for example, the Youngian of SU2, you will only find one R matrix and that R matrix has this very specific symmetric structure. The other thing you could try to do, and people have been starting to do this again a bit recently, is to try to directly solve the Maxwell equation. But this is, of course, very complicated, because as you saw, the Maxwell equation is a cubic equation and the R matrix is a matrix. So you will get a coupled set of cubic functional equations. And depending on how many components you have in your R matrix, things get out of hand really fast. So you can actually do this and work it out to an end, and you can use it to classify or find all solutions, say, of a subset of 4x4 or 9x9 R matrices. So the upside of this is that it's complete. So if you can solve this set of coupled equations all the way to the end, you will find all solutions of that form of the Maxwell equation. The downside, though, that it's, like I said, it's hard, because solving functional equations is hard in general, and especially if they're cubic and coupled with many different degrees of freedom. And so far, this approach mainly seems to work for R matrices that are of different form, so that have this that only depend on the difference of the rapidities.
Why is the word subset there?
The classification. So they didn't take all components of the 4x4 R matrix to be non-zero. Just say of 8 vertex type, where the diagonal and off diagonal are non-zero. If you take all of them, this approach breaks down. It's just too complicated. The set of equations you get are just a lot, and it's very hard to solve them, basically. Which comes down to the downside. It's just hard to solve these things. So if you have too many free parameters, it's just not tractable to solve it in this way.
I guess the restriction to difference form is a similar thing, right? You just have too many variables. And
Yes. Well, also, if it's not a different form, the functional form becomes more complicated, even. Right. So if you start expanding, you get partial derivatives instead of normal derivatives, and things just become way more complicated. Exactly. So our approach uses a slightly different way of looking at things. So we will use a thing called the boost operator to reduce the Maxwell equation to either a set of polynomial equations, in a sense, of different form, or a set of differential equations for non-different form. And then we can use it to classify. So for example, for different form, we were able to classify all four by four solutions with all components on zero. And we're almost done with actually doing this for the full non-different form 4x4 case. And so we found a bunch of new models in lots of different situations, and I'll discuss that in more detail later. So the upside of this model is that it's complete as well, just like directly solving the inverse equation, but it's more efficient. So we don't run into, at some point, we of course our equations also become very complicated, but we can push it further. So the downside for our approach is that we can only find regular solutions, which are solutions of the inverse equation that reduce to the permutation at some point, the permutation operators. So, and on spin chain language, this corresponds to spin chains that have nearest neighbor interactions. But these models are usually of interest anyway, especially for example for holography, where all the integrable models that appear are of this type basically. The other downside, as we will see, is that we actually find lots of solutions, and none of them are really independent. So we find models, a lot of models, and we have to sort of identify them, because solving it this way, you will get models that are the same upon reparameterizations or normalizations or some other trivial transformations. And so that's where our model, we generate basically too many dependent models. And at the end, we have to reduce our models to a set of generators.
So when you say that you get things that are nearest neighbor, really you get things that reduce to, that have a limit in which they become nearest neighbor, right? Like you can have, once you have some R matrix that is nearest neighbor, then you can dress it to add higher order things, right?
Yes. You can start from a nearest neighbor model and then extend it to a model that has longer range interactions. Exactly. That is.
Like the interactions have come at the given order, at least. They don't come all in one go. They are not genuinely sort of.
Yes. Exactly. I mean, you can extend it. Yes. Okay. So let me try to explain the idea behind our method. And the idea is starting from the Maxwell equation and going down to the level of the Hamiltonian, and then try to go back up. Okay, so consider any solution of the Maxwell equation. So we have an R matrix, just R UV of general form. And to this R, with this R matrix, you can build an integrable spin chain. So you can, so R is an operator from V tensor V to V tensor V. So you can create a spin chain of length L, where the Hilbert space is just L copies of the space V. And then you can define the usual monorbid matrix and the transfer matrix of the spin chain by just multiplying by adding a test particle, say particle zero, and then using the R matrix to scatter it with some L other particles on the chain and take the trace. So you get a usual transfer matrix, which defines an operator on your spin chain. And then from the Maxwell equation, it's very simple to show that TU will commute with TV. So I will set the rapidities of all the physical particles the same theta. So it's a homogeneous spin chain. Okay, so and then by expanding this T in the spectral parameter U, you get a commuting set of operators. This is sort of the standard construction, which corresponds to integrability. Now, for regular solutions, like I said, the R matrix reduces to the permutation operator when U is equal to V. And this corresponds to nearest neighbor spin chain. So you can see this by expanding the transfer matrix. So at leading order, if you put U is equal to theta, all the R matrices reduce to permutation operators, and you just get the shift operator. So that's usually considered the first commuting charge, which is just translation invariance. And then when you take the logarithmic derivative of the transfer matrix, you will get an operator, which has interaction range 2, So this operator acts on nearest neighbors, all neighbors. And this operator usually is taken to be the Hamiltonian, right? And it's given by the logarithmic derivative of the R matrix. And then if you expand the log of the transfer matrix further and further, you get more and more operators of increasing range. And this is the tower of conserved charges. Okay, so in this way, to any solution of the Young-Max equation, we can associate a regular solution, we can associate a Hamiltonian that is nearest neighbor interaction. So that has, okay, so consider such a Hamiltonian. Then you can actually, there's a second way of deriving or writing these higher conserved charges, Q3, 4, 5, and so on. Then rather than by expanding the transfer matrix, you can also use the boost operator. So which was defined all the way back in 82 by Tatelman and sort of generalized later by these people, which takes the following form. So the boost operator is defined in terms of the Hamiltonian, and it's a derivative of theta plus basically a boosted form of the Hamiltonian where the name of the boost operator comes from. So then you can show just by comparing the expansion of the transfer matrix and using the Young-Max equation basically that QR plus one can be written as a commutator of Q of the boost of QR with the boost operator. Now some of you might notice that this boost operator is only on spin chains that have infinite length. But actually this commutator consistently reduces to spin chains of finite size. So so while the boost operator is not really defined for say spin chains of finite length, the commutator is. So this equation actually makes sense for any spin chain, any length spin chain.
Sorry, also as n goes to infinity, that sum looks pretty divergent.
Yes, so you should see it as a formal sum. So how we actually derive it, if you take a spin chain of length L, and then you send formally L to infinity, and then you derive this equation. And basically what happens is the boundary terms telescopically sum. So you shouldn't really think of this as a really well-defined operator. It's more like the operator itself is maybe not so well-defined, the commutator is well-defined.
Marius, yes. What about periodic boundary conditions?
So, like I said, so this boost operator is only defined on say open infinite length spin chains. This commutator, however, is always defined because what you will see is that the problematic terms will cancel, and what you will left with if you commute this with an operator is an operator of length R plus one. So as long as your spin chain is length bigger than R plus one, this commutator is well defined. Also on closed spin chains with periodic boundary conditions.
But also if you assume your state on which you act has like all spin ups after some point, then it should be fine as an operator.
Right? Yes, as well. So in a sense, this is sort of an auxiliary operator that you can use to compute your densities of your conserved charges. And the spin chain itself doesn't really matter as long as it's big enough. But the interesting thing here is that this boost operator is completely defined in terms of the Hamiltonian as well. So this means that you can define the Q3, Q4, Q5, all in terms of the coefficients. So when you impose that Q2 or this Hamiltonian should come from a solution of the Young-Max equation, you need to have that Qn commutes with Qm, which will give you restrictions on the components of the Hamiltonian. So it will give you a set of differential equations because there's a d theta here on the entries of the Hamiltonian. So what we do is rather than try to solve the Max equation, we try to find all Hamiltonians which generate basically a tower of conserved charges. So, and then it's not guaranteed. Well, I go a bit ahead of myself. So what we try to do is we define a general Hamiltonian density, not knowing whether it comes from an R matrix or anything. Then we use the boost operator to compute Q3, Q4, Q5, and then we impose that all of these commute.
From that, so it's not guaranteed that they commute, right? If you
No, not at all, exactly. So then you impose that they commute, and that will give you a set of differential equations for your entries of the Hamiltonian. Then you try to solve them, and then you if you solve them, you get a set of Hamiltonians that possibly correspond to a solution of the Maxwell equation.
Excuse me, Marius, David is speaking, but a silly question, but what is in this case the use of the boost operator if it's not even ensured that the next charges are commuting with the one?
So the idea is the following. So you're right, it's not guaranteed. So, but the boost operator will define Q3, for example, purely in terms of Q2. Yes?
Correct.
So if you then impose Q2 with Q3 equals zero, it will give you some conditions on Q2. And those conditions we try to solve. And if they are solved, then your Q2 was possibly integrable. So,
do you need to keep checking that Q2 commutes with Q3, Q4, and then 3 with 4? I mean, it looks like infinitely many conditions.
Yes. I agree, and I'll come to this now. So, like you said, we cannot solve all the commutators, right? So, in order to actually prove that this possible Hamiltonian is an integrable model, we would need to find the R matrix. Because we can compute Q2 with Q3, maybe you can do up to Q5, but at some point it stops. What we do, actually, what it turns out is that in all our models, imposing Q2 with Q3 is enough. If you impose that, all the other commutators actually automatically cancel in all our models that we've seen so far. And we don't really understand why. We tried to prove it, but we failed. But it's sort of a experimental fact that we found so far.
That may be connected to the form of the boost operator, no? So to the fact that we know it should work of this specific an operator of this form to generate the charges, no?
Not really, in the sense that because we can take a Hamiltonian which is not integrable. Just take any random Hamiltonian, and you can compute this tower of conserved charges, and they will not commute, right? Only for really really special Hamiltonians they will commute. And you're right. There is sort of a recursive structure because of this relation, but we try to sort of we try to prove this. That Q2 with Q3 would imply also that the higher ones would vanish, but it's not so clear. The form of the boost operator does not seem to be enough to at least naively to prove this. But you're right, there is some structure here that probably makes it work.
So sorry, just a bibliographical question. Okay. No, go. Yes. Dima.
Yes. So, Marius, do you have a theorem that, like, whatever matrix is regular, computing conserved charges using boost operator to give you correct answer? I mean, works. Is it a theorem of this type?
Can you repeat what's exactly?
This type of means that it's permutation zero. If you compute commuting charges using expansion of transfer matrix,
yes,
then I can also compute it using boost operator.
Yes.
Okay, this is a theorem, right?
Yes, it's a theorem. Yes.
Okay. So two questions then. You need homogeneous spin chain. All thetas are equal at each spin chain.
Yes.
And do you know generalization when thetas are not equal?
No. Because if the thetas are not equal, then you will not get the nearest neighbor Hamiltonian. Because you really need that you get permutation operators. Most of the R matrix is reduced to permutation operator. Otherwise, all your operators will be of range L.
But once you have R matrix, once you have R matrix, you can now update it to inhomogeneous.
So exactly. No. So, but for the boost operator to work, the boost operator only works on homogeneous spin chains.
Can't you put it like in the sides of the sum, like the derivative with respect to theta alpha inside of the sum? It will not work.
There might be a generalization. That's right. I mean, I'm not aware of it, but yes. I mean, you're right. You can do something, but the biggest problem for us is that. Then you would really need to modify this a lot because your Hamiltonian will not be nearest neighbor anymore. Mm-hmm. Because when you expand the transfer matrix, you need that most R's become P's. Right. Otherwise, you will just get a horrible mess that's of range L. And for our sort of method to work, we really need our Hamiltonian or our building block to be, say, nearest neighbor. Otherwise, it would depend on the length of your spin chain and then basically our method breaks down. So that's why here we restrict to homogeneous ones. But like Kolya said, if you have the R matrix, then you can of course upgrade it to an inhomogeneous spin chain without any problems.
Okay, and for the same reason, I mean, for higher arm cases, these are not all commuting charges you are getting in this way. I mean, you need to make fusion of R matrix to get more commuting charges. But you then don't care as well because, well, if you want R matrix, you can do fusion later.
Yes, exactly. Okay. Yeah, that's right.
But fusion is not guaranteed. Fusion, again, depends on the shape of R matrix.
Yes.
Yes, you need that it reduces to projector or something like this at some point, at least.
Yes. So, but all these things sort of depend on the explicit form of the R matrix that you would find from this method. Okay, so, the other thing I would like to mention is that if the R matrix is of different form, then actually the Hamiltonian is constant, because basically it depends on U minus V, so the derivative terms cancel. So you don't get differential equations, but you get just polynomial equations instead. Okay, so as we discussed,
What order polynomial equations?
Cubic.
Always cubic?
If you do Q2 with Q3, you get cubic. So if you do Qn with Qm, you get n plus m minus 1 is the order of the polynomial.
Independent of the size of the...
Independent of the size of the, yes.
Thanks.
Okay, so... like we discussed, we can't prove or compute all of these commutators. So at some point we have to try to find the R matrix. So, but we now have some extra information. So we know that our R matrix is regular. So the first term in say the expansion should just be the permutation operator. And we know that the derivative gives the Hamiltonian. So we also know the first term, the Hamiltonian, which we know now because it's one of our solutions that we found. And then you can try to plug this expansion in the Young-Bach equation and see if you can solve it perturbatively, which is an approach sort of done by Izumi way back. And you can get some success by this. For example, you can show that the next term is basically Hamiltonian squared, but then it again quickly becomes very complicated. So in practice, this is not really a suitable way of finding an R matrix from Hamiltonian. Because you can run into the same problem because you might encounter some contradiction at, I don't know, order of 100. So what we do is sort of in between. So we solve this, usually this power series to the first few orders and see if we can find some relation between the components of R, see which R is zero or which are the same. And what we then do is we take the Young-Bach equation and we just expand it to first order. Then you get an equation which is called the Sutherland equation, which looks like this. So dot is a derivative, So you get R13, R23. If you commute with the Hamiltonian, you get basically the derivative of the R matrix, roughly. So this is a set of non-linear differential equations, which are quadratic in the components of R. But they use as input the Hamiltonian, which is what we know now. So remarkably, again, this is in principle solvable for all our models that we found. And again, I'd like to mention that the implication only goes one way. It's not clear that any solution of this equation will give you a solution for the Mbax equation, right? Because this is a consequence of the Mbax equation, it doesn't go the other way. So our recipe book is the following. So we start with the general Hamiltonian. We compute the higher charges by using the boost operator, and then we impose that Q2 with Q3 equals to zero. Then we get possible integral Hamiltonians. Then we solve this Sutherland equation. Then we get a set of possible integral R matrices, possible R's that solve the Mbax equation. And then we have to plug them in the Mbax equation to see whether or not they actually solve them. And in this way, we can find all regular solutions of the Mbax equation corresponding to a Hamiltonian that we started with.
So the advantage of these more sort of complicated, well, not complicated, but the step-by-step thing is that you go from a cubic equation to a quadratic one, basically, when you have to solve this Sutherland equation.
Yes.
Like the hard thing computationally, I guess, is that one, right? Or
yes. And in order to do that, you need a Hamiltonian. So yes. So yeah, you basically reduce the degree of the equations that you need to solve, in a sense. Yes. But now you need to do the steps, mm-hmm. if you want. Okay, so...
Also, another question. Has it ever been the case that the very last step has failed?
No. So remarkably, all these... it never fails. So Q2 with Q3 is enough. So Sutherland is also enough. So when we derive all this, indications can only go one way, but we have never seen a model where Q2 with Q3 commutes, but not Q2 with Q4. Or where we solve Sutherland and it doesn't satisfy the Mbax equation.
Okay.
We don't have a proof for this, but we compute a lot of different models and it always works. It would be interesting to find a proof of this, but we weren't able to find it.
Actually, it was sort of counterexamples, but so far there was no single.
So far everything always works, which is, I guess, the power of integrability in a sense. But it came as a surprise to us, actually, because we were expecting also to impose higher commutators or have some extra freedom from the Sutherland equation. But so far, no.
And given possible integrable Hamiltonians, do you have multiple solutions of Sutherland or like unique solution?
Unique solution. You can roughly see it. So this is a quadratic partial differential equation, but A, you have two boundary conditions. So you know that R at UU is the permutation operator and R at, and the derivative of R at U, U is the Hamiltonian. So actually you have two boundary conditions, which are actually functional. So it's sort of two lines in the space. And also this, it turns out that these set of Sutherland equations are actually very overdetermined. You generally have more equations because it's a matrix equation than degrees of freedom, roughly. So it's in practice they're always quite overdetermined, and you have enough boundary conditions to fix all the free constants that might appear when you solve these differential equations.
So can I ask you something? So you are saying, if I understood correctly, that once you find the Q3. You are done. You have you don't know why, but you have an infinite series of other conserved charges automatically.
Yes.
So it's a sort of Parker's theorem.
Yes. So it actually, well, I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself, but it sort of agrees with the old conjecture in integrability by Mathieu and Grabowski, who said something similar. So they computed in a few models, but they never proved it. But we find the same, exactly.
Marius, maybe just to clarify, but there is no still proved strict conditions that your first commutator is saturated and provides you unique solutions for the whole hierarchy is vanishing automatically. There is no proved condition. The maximum condition people have is the Reshetichin condition, which is not a complete proof for the hierarchy to vanish.
So we don't have a proof, but it's an experimental fact. And right now the evidence is quite strong. The final thing I want to mention is the identifications. Like I said, if you have a solution of the Ambrosius equation, you can normalize it in any way. It will still satisfy the Ambrosius equation, clearly. You can also reparameterize all your parameters in any way you want, or your spectral parameter in any way you want, because clearly that will also be compatible with the Ambrosius equation. You can also just apply basis transformations locally, which is, you can see is just a gauge transformation. And there are also discrete transformations like space inversion and just transposition. So when we solve our set of equations, we will in principle find all kinds of different instances that use these transformations, and we will identify all solutions that can be mapped to each other by using these. For example, we won't give R and R transpose as different solutions. So all these identifications have a trivial effect on the spectrum. So normalization of the R matrix just is a shift in the energy. Reparameterization of spectral parameter is a normalization of the Hamiltonian, and so on. But there's another identification that we'll sometimes use, which is twist, which is model dependent. So if you have an R matrix, which say commutes with some matrices, then you can define a twisted R matrix in this way, which again will be a solution to the Ambrosius equation. Now, as you all probably know, that twist really changes the physics of the model. For example, if you put in a twist or a magnetic field in the Heisenberg spin chain, the spectrum completely changes. I mean, you lift the degeneracies and so on. So the physics of the model is completely different, but the R matrix is still related by this very simple transformation. And since we're focused here on the R matrix in solutions of the Ambrosius equation, rather than the physics of the potential models, we will identify also by using these twists. Okay, so that's a whole lot to take in. So let me work out an explicit example and show you how we do it. Okay, so one of the simplest examples you can write down is take a Hamiltonian, which is 4x4. And let's say we take these four central block to be non-zero. So we have four free parameters, h1, h2, h3, and h4. So you plug this in the boost operator, you compute q3, and then you impose that q2 with q3 equals zero. Like I said, you get a set of differential equations. And what you find is that they correspond to the following very simple ones: h3 dot times h1 plus h2 is h1 dot plus h2 dot times h3, and the same for h4. So if your functions h1, 2, 3, 4 satisfy these conditions, then q2 with q3 equals zero. Now, these are very simple to solve, of course. So you see that you should take h3 is just a constant times h1 plus h2, and the same with h4. So a potential Hamiltonian that's integral of this form needs to have h3 and h4 defined in this way. Otherwise, it will not be integrable. Okay, so then the next step is to see if we can solve the Sutherland equation. So we plug this Hamiltonian in our Sutherland equation. You can easily see that you need to take the R matrix of this form. So it's of x, zeta if you want. So R1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So six components. And you plug it in the Sutherland equation. Now, you can solve with brute force. I've done it, but you can make your life a lot easier by using all the identifications. So first, you can set h1 equals to h2 by using a local basis transformation. And then you can use the normalization of the Hamiltonian to set h1 equals h2 to be 1. And then you've basically gotten rid of all the functional dependence, and your Hamiltonian is just a constant, and it's basically just the XXC Hamiltonian. So you can take the usual R matrix for X and Z, and redo the basis transformation and the reparameterization. And what you find is the following. So if you ISR defined capital H plus minus as the integral of these functions, H1 and H2. And this W, this omega is just this, this numerical factor. Then the R matrix that you find is this. And you can check that this solves the Max equation. And this is also the solution that you find if you brute force solve it. But that would take me four or five slides to do. So furthermore, you also see that it's of non-difference form. So if it would only depend on H plus or H minus, you could say that it's of difference form, see? Because it's of this integral, U and V are in the boundaries of the integrand. So this will be of the form H plus of U minus H plus of V. So that looks of difference form. But since you have a plus and a minus here, you cannot write this this R matrix as something minus something else. So this is a proper R matrix of non-difference form that corresponds to this Hamiltonian. So
sorry, I missed something. You just on the same slide you have H1, H2 equal to 1.
Yes. Okay, so that's a bit okay. So you can do a local basis transformation and set H1 is equals to H2. Then you can do a reparameterization of the spectral parameter to normalize your Hamiltonian such that H1 and H2 is equal to 1. Yes? And for the simpler Hamiltonian, you can solve the Sutherland equation. And then you can go back to the general case by undoing this reparameterization and undoing the local basis transformation. So then you get H1 and H2 back in your Hamiltonian.
But also means that like in special coordinate choice, it's of difference form and moreover H minus equal to 0.
No, it's not of difference form because the local basis transformation will depend on U and V. So let me, oh, sorry. Here. So it will be, so this R will be of difference form, but this part not. So it sort of factorizes into difference form and non-difference form if you want, in this case.
But if you take trace, this cancels out, right?
If you take trace, it cancels out, yes. Yes. But that's sort of a special case for this model. Later on, we'll see models where it doesn't factorize in this simple way, where it's actually properly of non-difference form. Because I agree, this is sort of difference form just dressed in a fancy way, if you want. But that's because we took a very simple example. So this proves that the only integral Hamiltonian, so the only R matrix that solves the Max equation that has a Hamiltonian of this form is this. So this is a in principle full classification of these types of R matrices from the Hamiltonian. R matrices from the Max equation. Okay, now let's now do this for real, and let's try to do this of difference form first. So I will take the R matrix of difference form, and everything just reduces to a set of polynomial equations. So we take a general ansatz for our Hamiltonian, so H AB, so which has full 16 components, so just full 4x4. And then we again use a local basis transformation to set the sort of outermost off diagonal components to 0. You can always do this. And then we can post Q2 with Q3 equals 0. And after a lot of work, you find that there are something like 400 different solutions to the set of polynomial equations. But after all our identifications, we find that there are only 14 independent solutions of this. So 8 correspond to known models and 6 models were new. So the complete classification of the 4x4 solutions of the Max equation, where the R matrix is of different form.
May I ask, how do you go from 400 to what was that, 14? Like so, painstakingly one by one, or do you have like a smart?
Painstakingly one by one, roughly. We just use Mathematica and just compare brute force. Well, some of them are very simple to see whether or not they're related or not, but the rest is just brute force plugging them into Mathematica, basically, and just compare roughly one by one. It's not fast, and it might be a more effective way, but that's how we did it in this case, yeah. So the eight known models were all of eight vertex type, which have the diagonal and the off diagonal, and they correspond to the XXZ spin chain, XYZ spin chain, and so on, and some small variations. So the new models that we found basically came into six new classes, which all look sort of the same. So one type looked like this. So these are upper triangular. So in this case, for example, it has four free parameters, A1, A2, A3, and A4. And the R matrix takes this somewhat complicated form, but it's of a trigonometric type, as you can see. It just depends on some cinches. And that's something we find. So they're either just rational or trigonometric. And you can check that this R matrix indeed satisfies the Max equation and gives us this Hamiltonian. So the other sort of type we found is not completely upper triangular, but has one component on the lower triangle. And again, the R matrix that we find here is sort of has a sort of a similar form. And in this case, it's completely regular. So all the new models we found had this off diagonal or upper triangular type structure, which was a little bit disappointing in a sense, because all the Hamiltonians we found were non-Hermitian, and even worse, most models were actually even non-diagonalizable. So if you compute the transfer matrix, you get Jordan blocks. And even if you could reduce it to something that is diagonalizable by setting some parameters to zero, you basically reduce to known models, for example, the XXX spin chain or something. And some models even were nilpotent, so Hamiltonian squared to zero. So these models do not seem to give really physically interesting models in the direct sense. They can still be interesting because Hamiltonians like this do appear also in fishnet theories. And people have been looking at this from twisted Hopf algebras and the von Jungian as well. But yeah, so all our models take this upper triangular form. And the spectrum, at least from a spin chain point of view, doesn't seem to be very, very exciting. And like I said before, all solutions.
What does it mean, spectrum is not very exciting?
It means that either the spectrum is, basically the spectrum is trivial, or it just corresponds to the spectrum of the XXX spin chain. So all these parameters that you see here, A1, A2, A3, they basically do not really affect the spectrum at all. So in that sense, it's not very exciting.
I see.
It's so in a sense, all physically interesting models or physically interesting spin chains have already been found. So maybe all of these models can be mapped in a non-trivial way by some non-local basis transformation or something. I'm not sure, but yeah. So in that sense, physically they don't seem to be very interesting. So we were happy that we were able to classify all these solutions, but a bit disappointed that all the new models that we found didn't really give any interesting physical spin chains.
Yeah, Marius, maybe just one note. I think still in these models that you show, people have studied them in the past, like for example, Kulish and Stolin, and they have found that what we find is a sort of a generalization to this Q-deformed quantum algebras that they have found in the past, which has actually certain generalized formations of the SL2 block, SL2 sec.
Yes, and like I also said, the only thing we needed to implement here was Q2 with Q3 equals zero, and which agrees with this conjecture by Grabowski and Mathieu that I alluded to earlier.
Sorry, Maurice, I have a question.
How does this relate to the Belavin-Dreyfus classification? It seems that you're converging somehow, at least in this particular case, to the models classified by the solution of the classical bit, the equation.
I am not sure. We didn't look at the classical limit of this. Basically, I'm not sure. So we stopped at this, and we didn't try to study the quantum groups or quantum algebras that these R matrices generate, because this one, for example, is rational, so probably it gives something of a Jungian type, and then or a deformed Jungian type, and it would be interesting to see what exactly this algebra would be, and then maybe get some understanding. But we didn't do that. We just stopped at the classifying the solution for the Max equation for this.
Do you find the elliptic R matrix here?
Yes.
I was a bit confused.
Yes. So, but that was the already known. Those were already known. We didn't find any new elliptic there.
Oh, okay.
So all these new models have either trigonometric or rational dependence on the spectral parameter.
So these upper triangles, there's no good symmetry or similarity transformation to make it more symmetric. So it's really
you can make it a little bit more symmetric if you want. Yes, you can apply a local basis transformation, but you can't make it purely symmetric or emission. That will not work. So you will always have something of the form, basically something emission plus something anti-emission, roughly. You can bring it to that form if you want. But purely symmetric or emission, that can't be done. Okay, so
about this conjecture, does their conjecture involve the assumption of nearest neighbor interactions as well?
Not really. Their conjecture is more like, if I have Hamiltonian and I can find some Q3 that commutes with it, then it's integrable. Okay. So it's a slightly different version of.
Do they give an example where it is non-nearest neighbor? Because that seems like it might be an important, actually, additional assumption.
They discuss models on sort of a different lattice, sort of a honeycomb type lattice, or sort of a seesaw lattice, where you would have next to nearest neighbors interactions, I think.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So they don't do just nearest neighbor.
Yeah. Okay.
But again, it's a conjecture, and
yeah.
They don't have proof. Okay.
Thanks.
Okay. So then on to non-difference form. We're still working on the full classification, but we first just restricted to 8 vertex type. For several reasons. One reason was that all the new models that were not of this form seemed to be physically sort of uninteresting. And the other reason is that if you want to extend this to a supersymmetric case, which I forgot to mention here, you can generalize everything to graded version, to 1/1 instead of 2. So in order for that, you want your R matrix to be even, otherwise it doesn't really make sense. So, which means that it has to be of 8 vertex type as well. So, that's why we restricted to Hamiltonians of this form. So, if we run through our whole machinery, we actually find only 4 independent models, which you call 6 vertex A and B and 8 vertex A and B. So, the 6 vertex A and the 8 vertex A models are basically the correspond to the example I showed earlier. They're just rest versions of the normal 6 vertex and 8 vertex model. So all the non-trivial spectral parameter dependence comes from basis transformations, twists, redefinitions of parameters, and so on. But model 6 vertex B and 8 vertex B are actual honest models of non-difference form. And let me show you these. So in 6 vertex B, what we find is if we put H6 equals to H7 and H8 to be 0, then this Hamiltonian is integrable for any choice of functions H1 to H5. So all the differential equations are automatically satisfied. Okay, so in principle there are five free functions.
Which ones again are 6, 7, and 8?
Okay, let me show you. So 6 multiplies SZ, tensor SZ. So that's sort of the ZZ spin interaction, which you would usually have in the XXX spin chain, right? And H7 and H8 are the furthest off angle components that sort of make it into XYZ or XXZ type.
Thanks.
Okay. So there are in principle 5 different functions. So 3 of the functions we can absorb in identifications, like a local basis transformation and normalization and some shifts by identities. So there are actually 2 really independent functions that are non-trivial. So the R matrix that we find from our machinery takes then the following form. So it's sort of suggestively close to a normal R matrix. So again, capital H is just the integral of little h. And we find one piece that's diagonal and one piece that's almost a permutation operator. So in particular, if you would set H5 to be 1, for example, then this is just a permutation operator. And this becomes the graded identity operator, basically. And then we have this H4, and then it's basically of different form. See, because if we set H4 to be constant, then capital H4 is just X minus Y, as you can see. So this is sort of a, if you want, a slight variation of different form. But it's, as you can see, it's properly of non-different form. Because we have products of H's, H5, with X and Y, and so on. So this is the R matrix that we find. And like I said, setting HI to be constant, we get the standard XXZ type R matrix back. But as you can see, there's a lot of freedom here because you can take any function for H4 and H5, and this R matrix will satisfy the Mmax equation. So in particular, you can take H5, not constant, but I don't know, logs or anything that's well defined, you get a pretty wild looking R matrix that depends on very complicated functions, but it will satisfy the Mmax equation. Okay, then for 8 vertex B, life is a bit more complicated because we do get a set of differential equations by imposing the Q2 with Q3 equals to 0. And we get 3 of such differential equations. And as you can see, they're highly non-linear and pretty difficult to solve. But after staring at it for a long time and trying a lot of different redefinitions and substitutions, you find that defining H3 and H4 in this way, so introducing B1 and B2 in this way rather, these equations actually simplify and you can write down a solution. So B2 is given in terms of B1 as follows. Again, capital B is just the integral of little b. And H7 and H8 give 2 constants and then they're proportional to H5 and these integrals. So this Hamiltonian, H5 is free, and then the rest of the components are given by this. So this Hamiltonian is integrable. And then you can try to solve the Sutherland equation, which is complicated again, because, but this time it gives Jacobi elliptic functions. So you can do some redefinitions. You can introduce a parameter k, which is the elliptic modulus as C7 over C2. You can do a basis transformation and set C7 equal to C8. And you can introduce a function eta, which is related to this function H5 that we have here, which is still free in this way to make things look a little bit nicer. And what we find that the R matrix is of elliptic, or sort of mixed elliptic and trigonometric form. So this all these Jacobi elliptic functions Sn, Cn, and Dn have modulus k squared, so that depends on the ratio of these parameters, and they depend on u minus v, so that part is of different form. But this function eta spoils the different form, So eta plus minus is just eta u plus minus eta v. And what you find is the following nice combination. So you have sine of eta plus, and cosine of eta plus, and eta minus, and so on. So this is an actual proper solution of non-difference form. And again, if you set eta to be constant, things reduce again to normal, to basically normal XYZ type model, because some of these signs will cancel. The sign of eta minus will cancel, and this square roots will just add up square and give something normal, give a normal sign. So this concludes the full classification of all solutions of the Max equation of say eight vertex type, where you have the two off diagonal ones. So there are only four independent solutions. So they're either this six vertex A, B, or eight vertex A and B. And two of these were new, as far as we can tell. These two models we've never seen in the literature before. And like I said, they're honors of non-difference form. I don't know if we want to have a break or not before
I think now might be a good time.
Because now is in principle a good time for me to go to a break.
Okay, great. Then let's have a 10 minute break. And yeah, of course, people can keep discussing if they want. But just to let you know, the recording it will go on, because Kolya had to leave. Okay, so see you in 10 minutes.
Hi, Marius.
Hi.
Maybe I have a question. I'm Carlo.
Yes.
So the question is, you look at the equation at the beginning, Q2, Q3, commutator is zero.
Yes.
So Q2 is a sum of nearest neighbor things, let's say, and Q3 is a sum of three things that involve three things.
Range three, yes.
And I'm asking if essentially you can extract the same condition just by manipulations of the Young-Baxter equation, expanding, for example, around permutation point, all of them. I mean, if you can do formal manipulation on the Young-Baxter.
Yes, you can.
Okay.
Yes, you can, but it's a little bit more involved, because if you do that, you get a thing called the Reshetnikin condition.
yes, that's but then usually for the difference. Uh-huh.
Yes, but yes. So, but yes, you can also do it by manipulating the Young-Baxter equation. Yes, exactly. Because in a sense, all these things also come from the Young-Baxter equation. The boost operator you can basically follows from expanding the Young-Baxter equation, mm-hmm. and then you basically take the transfer matrix and start expanding it, and then use the Young-Baxter equation in order to derive it. So all of these things are related. Yeah.
Hi, can I ask a question?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm a non-expert in this field. I'm from high energy.
Mm-hmm.
My motivation for studying the Young-Baxter equation comes from quantum gravity. So yes. In particular, I'm very interested in understanding the relationship between ADS and the Young-Baxter equation.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know whether you will like give the necessary background, or if you have already given that, but I was hoping maybe you could, you know.
I will discuss a little bit. The focus here is more on the Young-Baxter equation. So I'm
okay.
I will discuss a little bit applications of this to say the integrable models that appear in ADS 2, ADS 3, okay. and maybe ADS 5.
Okay.
But I won't really So I'll say maybe a bit, but probably not too much, unfortunately. Sorry.
All right. Okay.
Marius, can I ask another question?
Sure.
So, all your R matrices reduce to permutation at some point.
Yes.
I suppose not all reduce to identity or graded identity at some other point.
No.
Okay, yes. So that's where you're more general, I think, than Belavin Dreamfield.
Yes. Yeah. For example, here, this one. If you send u to zero, you get the identity. But say if you send u to infinity, which is what you usually would do, you actually get some really singular point here. Mm. So yes, in general, that won't work. So which is why it's not so always so easy for these models to sort of get a proper quantum algebra out of
this. Yes.
Because if you want commutators, then you need that it reduces the identity at some point. And lots of these models do, but not all.
This thing that u to infinity, I mean, u also reduces as a limit when you send u to infinity. That would be something that you might want for having a QFT interpretation of the thing, I think. Like there is some condition on behavior at large rapidity, right?
Yes. So.
For local or. Like,
yes.
Or less local QFTs.
No, it would be very interesting to see if there are QFTs for some of these models that actually have this as a scattering matrix. We have no idea how you would actually prove this or show this, but that would be a very, very interesting question.
Marius, but well, this is kind of simple R matrix in a sense. You could do the usual RDT machinery as, let's say, define a Yangian.
Yes.
Abstractly, you get the defining relations and then yes. you run yes. through these associated graded. And I guess in the end, you would get this is still some kind of GL2 fancy deformation extension.
Probably, yes. Yes. Especially for these type of simple models where the R matrix is just rational, basically.
Yeah.
There should be a way to map this to some deformed fancy Yangian. Yes, I completely agree. Yes. For some of the other ones, like this one, it will be more complicated.
Yeah, as long as it goes, if you get just one parameter, like it's a difference, expression is in terms of difference,
yeah,
it's fine. Yeah, it's very easy.
Yes, in these cases, it's all of the difference, exactly, yes.
Yeah, because if not, then you have to do what you did long time ago with Nicholas.
Yes. And that's actually something we did for some of the models, and I'll discuss that when we come back from the break.
Okay. I never had sufficient, I was never brave enough to read that paper fully.
So for example, for this model, you can do what I did with Nicholas and get the RTT out for this model.
Are you sure me? Do you hear me?
Are you sure?
I want to add something, if you don't mind.
Yeah, sure.
Do you know that you're... What do you mean for me? Kolya, what do you want for me?
In the chat.
Okay, can I start?
Yes, please.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so... So let me now... discuss a few applications of what we just did to ADS2 and ADS3 before going to higher dimensions applications of our method. So because with this, we can also classify integrable or integrable deformations of the integrable ADS2 and ADS3 sigma models. So for example, the ADS2 integrable sigma model has some masses and massless modes. Alessandro worked a lot of this, and they derived an R matrix for these massive modes, and the armlet is 4x4 because there are 2+2. And this R matrix is exactly of 8 vertex type. Because it needs to be even. So Alessandro derived this together with Ben 6 years ago already. So in this case, it depends on the Zhukovsky variables, x plus and x minus, that you usually relate to the momentum and the mass and the coupling in this way. So an explicit form is pretty unpleasant. And I won't give it here. It would take more than a slide, I guess. It's a really ugly form. But we can actually map it to our 8-vertex B model. So it's a special case of that. So when we set C2 equals to 0, which corresponds to sending K to infinity, we see that we can reduce R model to the ADS2 R matrix if we define our functions H1, H5, and B, which were the free functions in our R matrix, in our Hamiltonian, if we relate it to the Zhukovsky variables in this way. And like I said, we need to take K to infinity, so you need to be a little bit careful when you do this, because you need to rescale the spectral parameters and the functions in order to properly take this limit because of the Jacobi elliptic functions. So what we see that the ADS2 massive integrable scattering matrix is a special case of our 8 vertex B, and B, this shows that there is only a one parameter integrable deformation of this model. And the parameter that parameterizes this is the elliptic modulus K, or C2 in a sense, one of the constants in our model. So that completely classifies. So in this case,
is that going to end up being the mixed flux?
I am not sure. So at the moment we don't quite know what the interpretation of this is.
Well, it better be, because
hopefully.
Sorry. Well, no, I mean that one is, you know,
yes,
that one's nice and happy.
I'm a little bit confused because there are also deformations such as quantum deformations of these, certainly of ADS3, probably also of ADS2. I think that some.
No. So, not yes. Interesting question. Not for ADS2. For ADS3, yes. Not for ADS2.
Oh, I see. Sorry, that was my ignorance.
Maybe actually I'm also jumping the gun. I wonder. I guess I don't really know if in ADS2 you can have mixed flux.
Actually, I think possibly not. Well, I don't know.
Is the ADS2 geometry, can you remind me, is it supported by Ramon freeform flux?
I don't remember.
Yeah, neither do I. Okay, we can probably check that out later. Because if it's supported by Ramon freeform flux exclusively, then it should be equally supported by a mixed flux. But if not, then not.
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks. So, and then Alessandro also worked out, looked at the scattering of masses modes, and they did this by taking a limiting procedure where you send the mass to zero. So it would be interesting to see if that could also be done on this deformed integral model with this K. So like I said, we didn't really know of an interpretation of this. So we didn't really have any perturbative data, but to come back to the discussions that we're having in the break, we do have an R matrix, so we could work out the symmetry algebra of this model by doing the RTT. And since it's of non-difference form, you have to do a little bit of extra work, and you naturally get a braided co-product and a centrally extended algebra, just like with ADS5, like I did with Nicholas. So, and what turns out is that the formed model has the same symmetry as the underformed model, which is centrally extended PSU 1/1. But the extra parameter is a representation parameter rather than a symmetry algebra parameter. So you still have the normal, the same Youngian as the underformed model. But the K, the elliptical modulus appears in the representation. So, and the representation we can also compute, again, from the RTT relations. So we can extract the momentum, P, by computing the braiding factor. And the energy, we can do it from the central elements. And the same thing with the mass and all the other parameters. So if we do this, what we find is the following not so very nice deformation. So this, just to remind you, this function, capital function B1, is defined in x plus minus as follows. And these Jacobi elliptic functions are depend on x plus minus in the following way. So they are an arctangent of the square root of x plus times x minus. And then the formed u, so the braiding, so the momentum will be the log of this, takes this this very complicated form. And indeed, if you set k to infinity, what you'll see is that all the Jacobi elliptic functions nicely combine, and you just get the square root of x plus over x minus back, which seems like a miracle. So the moment, the mass and the energy also become deformed. So this function nk is basically 1 minus u squared up to some constants. So I didn't want to fully spell it out because it looked complicated, but the prefactor is pretty simple. So all the sort of relevant physical quantities get deformed by this parameter. So uk is still a phase, ek and mk are still real, and they also satisfy the normal dispersion relation, but with the same coupling h. The coupling h is not deformed by k, only the energy, mass, and momentum are deformed. And like I said, when k goes to infinity, it reduces to the normal ADS2. So it would be nice to if we could find an interpretation of this k. What exactly this corresponds to physically? If it's a, like Bogdan said, a flux or a proper deformation like the Q-deformed ADS5 model.
Could you show MK again?
Bogdan first.
Sorry, could you show MK again?
Yes. So this NK contains a lot of junk. It's basically 1 minus U squared.
Sorry, and U here is UK.
Yes, UK. I mean UK. Yes. So it's this horrible thing. So you basically get this from the central elements. Like if you commute Q with Q, you get H times 1 minus U squared, where U capital U squared, right? So you can get the mass and energy out of those relations basically.
But in particular, it depends on P. In some highly complicated way.
Yes.
As opposed to in a linear way.
Yes. And it all drops out in the K to infinity limit. So maybe you can do some redefinition to sort of get rid of it. But yeah, it sort of seems to make, well, that was one of the ideas that we had, that maybe this would, turning on K would kill the make all the masses most massive actually. And then setting K to infinity, you get master swaps back. But we didn't look at this in full detail yet. That was just one of the ideas that we had.
So I just wanted to comment that if this is the only deformation that you could find in your classification,
yes,
then chances are, I mean, there exists some quantum deformation. There exists this lambda deformation, I think, for ADS2. And I think it's, it's believed to be integrable, I think, at the quantum level as well. I'm not a complete expert. So, but then there will be some idea that this should reduce to that, at least in some sort of, I mean, near PP wave limit where you can compare things.
Yes. If that's the case, then yes. So, but we actually did try to Q-deform the algebra, the centrally extended algebra. And Paul did that, and that actually does not work.
But this lambda deformation, it is similar to some Q deformation where Q modulus 1. I'm sure that there are people in the audience that know these things way better than I do, so maybe I should just shut up and they can comment if they want.
So I think it's similar, but it can't be a proper Q deformation, like a standard one.
So one thing to actually comment on that, so if you work out the co-product for this deformed representation, you find that the co-product is exactly the same. It's just the usual U grading factor that you usually have. And the co-product usually for Q deformation gets extra factors of Q all over the place.
I see what you mean.
Yes, that's right, yes. Thanks. Okay, so this is the only integrable deformation that there is, at least that has an R matrix that goes with it. Okay, now to ADS3. So there, for example, an ADS3 times S3 times T4 with some RR flux. The massive S matrix, you can split it into chirality blocks. So you have left and right chirality. And these four blocks are all basically of 4x4 type. So they're all of the type that we just classified. In particular, the left-left and the right-right blocks need to satisfy the Yamaksen equation by themselves. And we find that they can be embedded in both the 6-vertex B and 8-vertex B models. So there are multiple possible integrable deformations, actually. In particular, if we embed it in the 6-vertex B type, we need to identify R functions with the Zhukovsky variables in this way. But there we encounter something very remarkable. So if you remember, in 6-vertex B, we didn't have any restrictions on our functions, which means that there is actually a functional deformation if you want, and you can still keep it integrable. And moreover, we can deform left-left and right-right independently and still lift it to a full solution of the Yamaksen equation by solving left-right and right-left. So if you build this full block, this full S matrix, you can actually solve left-right and right-left in terms of left-left and right-right. and like I said, you can deform left-left and right-right independently and functionally. Basically, there's an infinite, or even more than infinite, ways you can deform this model and still be integrable. Which is quite remarkable, because usually deformations just have one or two parameters. Maybe it's related to the special nature of two-dimensional CFTs. We're not quite sure. Also here, it's quite unclear what the interpretation is, because we're basically sort of only looking at this from the level of the R matrix in the Yamaksen equation.
Is it clear that there is a 2D CFT?
I'm not sure, which is why there's a question mark.
Yeah. I mean, the most likely thing, given similar cases in higher dimensions, is that there isn't a 2D CFT.
Yes.
Maybe can I ask, in this case, is it hopeless to do some sort of RTT calculation, or
not hopeless, but we haven't gotten around to do it yet. But it's not hopeless. But you'll have to put some restrictions on your functions, I think, to get something sensible out of it. Because you usually, to get RTT to work, you want it to reduce to graded identity or identity at some point. Mm-hmm. So as long as you impose something on your functions that say, when you go to infinity, some will drop off, some will maybe explode, then I think you can do something here, yes. Okay. It would be interesting to see what kind of algebra comes out here, yeah. Then there's another embedding, which is a little bit more more restrictive or more standard. Is if you embed it in 8B, 8 vertex B, then you have this identification of our functions in terms of the Zhukovsky variables. So then it emits an elliptic deformation. So if you turn on basically K, so C2, you get an elliptic type deformation. And in this case, the deformation is really just a parameter. And also the left-left and right-right blocks cannot be deformed independently. So the moduli actually need to be related. But also here it can be lifted to a full deformation. Because again, left, right, and right, left blocks can be fixed in terms of the left, left, and right, right blocks by just solving the Buxer equation. And also here, we have no idea about interpretation or the quantum algebra, but this one seems to be a bit more standard, because here we just in principle have one actual parameter, not a bunch of functions that we can vary and see how it deforms the model. The tricky part is that you need to send k to infinity. So on a practical level, you need to do a lot of rescaling, and it's very tricky to get the limit to work and to get it to work right. But this is in principle all a full classification of all possible integrable deformations of these holographic models.
Marius, sorry. So the one known example of the mixed flux here now in ADS3, where does it show up here? It must be some subcase or something.
I think it's a subcase of 6B, but I'm not completely sure. So we, as far as I can tell, all of them were embedded in 6B. I'm not quite sure if it's embedded in 8B. I don't.
Well, because you know, it should be it should come out very simply if you write down this M and so on, like you did in the ADS2 case,
should. Yes. I agree. So it might also be embedded in 8B, but I'm not quite. I don't remember actually. I'll look it up. Maybe Paul remembers. Do you?
It's Paul? Definitely in 6B. For 8B, I can't remember.
Yeah.
Maybe a comment. If 8B is sort of a, is it an elliptic? I mean, if it's elliptic, maybe it's not so likely that.
Yes.
That you can embed the mixed flux in there. On the other end, it's very nice that you have this condition within the left and the right, because it seems that you are implementing the fact that the relation between left and right is really a particle-antiparticle relation,
mm-hmm.
which from like just from Jan-Baxter you would not necessarily have. You have it when you start thinking about like crossing and more like quantum field theory properties.
Mm-hmm.
But it's very nice that somehow it comes out by consistency. Yes.
Yeah. So it's Yeah, that was actually quite non-trivial, and like I said, this is really an elliptic deformation. So this deformation has some non-zero entries in the R matrix that you don't have in the standard ADS3 case. So it's a really, really elliptic deformation in that sense.
Yeah, and just to say that this mixed flux is basically virtually the same as matrix, and you deform the Zhukovskis, yeah. Right? So it's probably not quite in this class.
Okay, so that's what I had to say about this two-dimensional case. Now in the last part of the talk, I'll discuss a little bit about four dimensions. So because this two-dimensional case is quite simple, and we were, it's already quite rich, but we wanted to see if our method also works for higher dimensional cases. So we decided to go to four dimensions, to see if we could find something that's close to ADS5 or the Hubbard model. So in this case, we took a four-dimensional Hilbert space, which is Φ1, Φ2, Psi1, and Psi2, which you can identify with basically electrons. So Φ1 would be an empty site, Psi1 and Psi2 would be electron spin up and spin down, and Φ2 would be an electron pair. An example of an integral model like this is the Hubbard model. Which has a Hopping term and a potential term, which counts the number of electron pairs roughly. And which is an important toy model for superconductivity. So we were going to see if our method can give the Hubbard model and maybe generalizations thereof. So the general case is too complicated, because you would have 256 free functions to solve. So we decided to impose some extra symmetry. So we imposed SU2 times SU2 symmetry. Similar to what you have in the Hubbard model, where you have charge and spin symmetry, or in the ADS5 model, where you have also the two SU2s. So in this case, the Hamiltonian only has 10 free parameters, so A until F, which makes this system a lot more tractable. Okay, so we were going to classify all integrable solutions of the max equation of this form. So first we did the difference form, and we found 12 independent solutions. In this case, so they're all in this table. So most of the models were actually known models. So models 1, 2, and 3 were sort of complicated embeddings of SU2 and SU1/1. There is the normal XXX spin chain, of course, SU4, the SP4 model as well. And one of the models is actually the free Hubbard model. So that doesn't have a potential term. So that's basically two copies of the XX spin chain. But we did find 5 models that we, again, couldn't find in the literature. It's models 4, 6, 8, 9, and 10. And let me tell you a little bit about these. So model 4 seems to be a modified version of the normal SU4 spin chain. It looks very, very elegant, and which made us suspicious that it's actually a known model, but again, we couldn't find it anywhere in the literature. So the Hamiltonian takes the following simple form. So it's 1 minus permutation, so that's the standard form of the Hamiltonian. But then there's a small term that's added to it, which looks like a two-dimensional Heisenberg spin chain. So it's the identity restricted to the first two basis elements and the permutation just restricted to the first two basis elements. So it's like adding an XXX spin chain and a lower dimensional XXX spin chain together. And you might think that you could add any relative constants between the two, but actually you can't. So you can only add them with equal weights for it to be integrable. So it's sort of a superposition of two XXX models. So the R matrix is actually just rational, which seems to indicate that there's some Jungian that underlies this thing. And again, it's just 1 minus permutation and sort of a deformed smaller Heisenberg spin chain to go with it. And it would be interesting to see what kind of the quantum algebra is and do a beta ansatz for this model. The spectrum seems to be quite non-trivial, even though the model is quite simple. And the other model, model 6, is obtained by sending the permutation to the graded permutation, basically. So those models are sort of graded versions of each other. And actually we showed that you can actually generalize this to SUN times SUN. So this you can generalize to any, basically N here and M here. So that's an interesting new model. So the other sort of weird new models were models 8, 9, and 10, which all have the components G, H, K, and L equals to 0. So what's so interesting about this is that if you look at the action of the Hamiltonian, these are actually the terms that describe the hopping of the electrons, which means that the electrons cannot hop by themselves. But when they're in a pair, so when you have a phi 1, phi 2, they actually can hop because the A, B, and C are non-zero. They can also split and join together. So what you have is here a basic model of electrons that can only move along a spin chain in pairs. But they do can, but the pairs can split and join. So it seems like sort of a basic model of superconductivity, actually. And the dynamics are very non-trivial, because there's a non-trivial interaction between the electron pairs and the electrons. So the R matrices, I won't give them here, but they're all of trigonometric type again. And models 9 and 10 are actually Hermitian, so they seem to define proper physical spin chains. And like I said, the spectrum is very non-trivial. And standard beta ansatz does not really work, because it's kind of hard to make a Magnon picture here. Because like I said, the fermion like degrees of freedom don't propagate along the chain. Only fermion pairs can propagate. But there is still a non-trivial interaction with fermions and the pairs. So we were able to compute the spectrum for 0, 1, and 2 excitations in this way. But beyond that, we could find very little structure and we couldn't really do much. So these seem to be very interesting models that have a very complicated physical picture. Yes?
But in that case, could you do algebraic beta and ZAS? Because this is still highest weight theory and...
But also in the algebraic beta ansatz, you usually need a reference state for things to work. You need to do some analytic beta ansatz or TQ relations in order to sort of try to avoid that.
But so our matrix has some extra things. Well, it is like it's smaller than Hubbard R matrix, meaning by non-zero entries.
Yes. So yes. There will be some. Yes.
Because,
but still, also in algebraic beta ansatz, you usually have a reference state, and yeah. Then you define creation operators. But here, it's not quite sure what this creation operator should be.
But if there is beta ansatz for Hubbard model, this one should be easier in a sense, or it's my naive expectation.
It's not completely clear. I don't think so, because in the Hubbard model, you do have an actual Macnaughton picture. I mean, you can create, say, electrons with spin up and spin down and move on the chain and do some sort of nesting procedure. I don't see how it would work here.
Okay.
But yes, I mean, it's possible that you can make it work. We didn't really sit down and try to do it yet, but it seems to be not so simple.
So, Marius, are you saying that once you set those coefficients to zero, basically you're killing the B operators that generate anything out of the pseudo vacuum?
Yes, you will kill yes.
In terms of finding spectrum from some kind of TQ relation, should be possible, right? Even if there is.
Yes. Because also, for example, for the XYZ spin chain, also there you don't really have a Macnaughton picture. But you can still do a TQ relation, right? And get the spectrum out. So yes, definitely it should be possible to get the spectrum, but probably not by standard coordinate or algebraic weight ansatz. You'll need to do something non-trivial, is my guess.
I think we check standard technique fail, but analytic ansatz, what Kolya suggests, must work.
So, and also these models, but just by looking at the spectrum, because we just computed the spectrum for chains up to length, I don't know, 6 or 7, they do have a lot of degeneracies in the spectrum. So there is some symmetry in these models. So that also sort of seems to suggest that there might be some handle on these models that makes it possible to solve them. But it would be interesting to understand the spectrum, the symmetries and the physical properties of these models. Because like I said, there seem to be very interesting dynamics where you only have electron pairs moving on the chain and sort of the electrons themselves seem to freeze out. And it would be really also interesting to find out if there is a 1+1 dimensional field theory that has this weird R matrix as a scattering matrix. Okay, then if you go to non-difference form, we actually find 7 models, which are all complicated. So models 1 to 6 have this form. They have a bunch of free functions like H1, H9, H10, and so on. But most of these models are non-emission because they all have C0. So they don't really reduce to the Hubbard model. So, but there is one model that has C not equal 0. So that better correspond to the Hubbard model or the ADS5 model. So in that case, you get a very complicated set of ordinary differential equations. And after a lot of work, you find that they are solved in terms of Jacobi elliptic functions. So you find an elliptic Hamiltonian and an elliptic R matrix. So, and like I said, this one, and the only free functions here that are in this model correspond to basis transformation, reparametrization, and normalization. So this should coincide with the ADS5 integrable model. And indeed it does. And moreover, what's interesting, it automatically gives the X plus the parametrization of the Joukowsky variables in terms of the elliptic functions that Klepp and Sergey wrote down a long time ago. Because we naturally get R Hamiltonian and R matrix completely in terms of elliptic function. and then comparing it with the Zhukovsky map, you basically find the torus parameterization of the Zhukovsky variables. You get it sort of for free here. So it's nice, but it also shows that there is no deformation of the ADS5 model or the Hubbard model that still has SU2 times SU2 symmetry, because the only thing we find is the Hubbard model, or the ADS5 model rather. So if you relax SU2 times SU2, you can find more general models, and indeed we found that, but that's a work in progress, because again, that's we get a lot of models with a lot of parameters, so it's hard to do classification there. But there are lots of interesting, there's a very rich solution space, it seems, if you start relaxing this.
Sorry, when you write SU2 times SU2, it does mean something like the D2 model or not?
Well, what I mean is the symmetry algebra is two direct copies of...
I know. But I know something like D2 hermetics, which is not enough, at least for me. And it's exactly direct product of SU2 and SU2, maybe direct sum.
Andrei, D2 is a manzam.
Sorry?
D2 is a manzam.
Yeah, I think it's one of the models in this table. I think it should be models it should be one of models 1, 2, and 3, I think.
1, 2, 3. Okay, thanks.
But found as embedding explicitly.
Because yes, so some models are sort of embeddings of two copies of SU2, like you said.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Yes. So yes, that's in there. Okay, so let me then sort of wrap up. So we sort of found a new efficient method of finding and classifying solutions of the Jan-Baxter equation, which works for regular R matrices, so which are spin chains with nearest neighbor interactions. So we classified all solutions of difference form of 4x4 of the Jan-Baxter equation, and it all 8 vertex type of non-difference form. I didn't present it here, but we actually also did 9x9 that respects some sort of ice type rule. And we also did 16x16, like I said, with SU2 times SU2 symmetry. And we found, we actually did full classification of each of those cases. And we found a bunch of new and possibly interesting integral models that have lots of things to study. And in this way, we could also classify integral deformations of, say, the ADS2 and ADS3 integrable models. So there are a bunch of open questions. So for all of the new models, there's a lot of work to do, because you can try to solve them, understand the physics, look at their quantum groups, their quantum algebras that they generate, the physical properties, do they have bound state, fusion, and so on. And further, for our procedure, there are a bunch of also other open questions. Can we find models, like I said, where Q2 with Q3 is not sufficient, or where the Sutherland equation is satisfied but not the Jan-Baxter equation? So far, no. And like I said, we studied a lot of different models, and it always seems to work. So are there field theories that have these new R matrices, scattering matrix? Can we do non-compact spin chains, for example, which would be also very interesting? Can we try to classify deformations of ADS5 times S5 for example, relaxing SU2 times SU2? So, and like I said, we're currently making lots of progress, or actually classifying all 4x4 solutions of the Jan-Baxter equation, all regular solutions of the Jan-Baxter equation. So there's lots of interesting things to do. Okay, so thank you.
Thank you very much for the very nice talk. Let's thank the speaker. And then, are there more questions for Marius?
Yeah, maybe I could ask. So you have this requirement of locality, right? So what does it mean in closed terms from the Young-Baxter equation. If I just like look at the Young-Baxter equation, which of them is local, which is non-local, is it the permutation which you need at some point?
Yeah, basically the permutation. I want the R matrix to, there should be a special point where your R matrix becomes permutation. So that's basically what.
Okay.
And if you start expanding the Young-Baxter equation, that's sort of important, right? If you, because you usually expand around this point, then everything sort of looks, and you can basically work with it.
Yeah, probably there were already lots of questions.
I have a question. Yes. Regarding long-range deformations.
Yes.
So I understand that once you have the R matrix, you can just construct long-range models but by just taking higher derivatives, but you will miss a lot.
Yes.
Have you thought about allowing for the higher charges to have an expansion in some parameter and generate in this way? I mean, can this be set up in this in your formalism?
So we did think about this, but we didn't really try to do this. So what would work is what say Nicholas and company did for the long range deformations. You can take each of the solutions that we found and then construct the long range deformations
right out
of that. So that would still work in this case, again, because they also use the boost operator, that everything is reduces, that everything is regular, right? Mm-hmm. So that will work for each of our models. It would be interesting if you could, like you sort of suggest, incorporate it in our framework and sort of do it in one go.
Right.
But I'm not completely sure how to do that. But that would be an interesting question. Would be nice, but we didn't try to sort of incorporate it in our method. So as far as I can tell it, you can do it step by step. So first this, then do the long range, but in sort of one package. I'm not quite sure how
okay.
to do it.
Also related to that, if you look at like long range spin chains or supersymmetric spin chains that appear in the context of ABS-CFT, they do not preserve the length of the spin chain. Would you imagine how to incorporate that as well? Like, you know, there's a higher range or at longer range, and for higher range spin chains, they might not preserve the length. So there might be transitions. Perhaps, I don't know if you could also imagine incorporating this type of loops.
Yeah. So no, we didn't think about this, but the situation is a little bit subtle because if you look at ADS5, for example, if you just look at Nicholas's R matrix, the ADS5 R matrix, that doesn't know, in a sense, anything about length changing or not. It's just an R matrix that satisfies the Young-Baxter equation.
Right.
And by that, you can compute the asymptotic spectrum.
Yes.
Without just doing algebraic breakdown dots with that R matrix, you don't need any length changing or whatever. And then in principle, if you have that, you can do quantum spectral curve or TBA and get the full spectrum. So you might not need to consider the length changing operators.
Sorry, I think that actually, if you look at Nicholas's S matrix as it's written, it would not satisfy the Young-Baxter equation, right? It would only satisfy it with some twists.
So you
have to change the coproduct so that, but I think as long as such a change of basis for the coproduct exists, then it shouldn't matter.
Yes, I agree. So you basically need to what Klebs called the string frame,
right.
And then you get the proper R matrix, and then yes.
All right. But yeah, as long as this string frame exists, you can just.
Yes, I agree. Yes.
Thank you.
So maybe just a silly question: what are your last three transparencies?
Oh, so those were the. So no
what,
one.
What questions should we have asked to have seen?
No one asked why the SO4 spin chain was missing, because SO4 is SU2 times SU2 as well, but that's because it's a different embedding of the two SU2s, and we also did that, and this is the the most general non-difference form solution at SO4 symmetry. So that's the other one is the 9x9, which just the form, and all of these armatures take the form roughly of 6 vertex B. So there's something that looks like a permutation time plus something that looks like just a diagonal matrix. These are a bit complicated, so I didn't spell them out, but we found 6 new models in this case, and they're all of 6B, which seems more of a universal form. And the last slide was related to Dima's question, whether or not you can derive or compute the boost operator, and here was a short derivation, where you take a Sutherland equation like this. You send A and B to K and K plus 1. And then you multiply from the left by some product of R, so from the right, so that you get a bunch of transfer matrices, and then a derivative of T, and the left-hand side sums to the boost operator, basically. So you get this equation, and then if you expand it, you get the boost operator out. So that's a short derivation, in case Dima wanted some more details of how to actually prove it.
Okay, we are over 2 hours now. Andre?
Hi. Okay, yeah. Are there any last questions? Maybe one last question, if somebody wants. Okay, then. So next week we'll have Sergei Lukiano at the same time. And yeah, so am I the host, right? Okay, so yeah, with this, thank you very much, Marius, again. And thank you, and see you next week. Bye-bye.
Marius?
Yes?
If you look at the chat,